Saturday, April 18th, 2009, and we're in Stillwater, Oklahoma, interviewing Ben Bancroft. Now, Ben, you've played on the 1959 National Championship Baseball Team, and you and your teammates are on campus today for your 50th year reunion, celebrating that championship season. And I want to ask you a couple of questions about the team and the championship year, but first, could you give me a little bit of background on where you grew up and your early life?
Well, I grew up in San Antonio, Texas. Joel Horlen and I played on a national championship team, a Pony League team, when we were 14, and wound up playing for Oklahoma State. Coach Green came down and saw us play one summer in San Antonio and offered us scholarships here, so we came up together to play at OSU. My father was a national champion wrestler here in 1929, and I think he probably wrote a letter on our behalf, and my high school baseball coach was also an Oklahoma State graduate, so I'm sure he wrote a letter for us too. So we were happy to be able to come up to Stillwater to go to school and play ball.
Wow, what were your first impressions of Coach Green?
Well, of course, the first time I saw him is when he came out to see Joe and I play, and I was favorably impressed. We didn't visit with him very long. The first real encounter I had with Coach Green is one I'll never forget. I got into an inter-squad game when I was a freshman up here, and I never played the outfield before. I always played shortstop and third base in high school, and he put me into right field in an inter-squad game, and they hit three fly balls out to me, and I never saw any of them. I lost them in the sun, and they all hit the ground, and Coach Green called me names I'd never even heard of before, and I know it was going through his mind. He was thinking, I've got this kid for a scholarship for 4 years, you know, and I felt terrible about it, but fortunately, I improved my performance over the years up here.
Well, that's good. Now, while you were here on campus, what was your major?
I was a general business major. I think I started out thinking I was going to be an engineer, and then I took calculus, and I decided I don't think I'm going to be an engineer. So I wound up getting a general business degree.
And your freshman year was what year?
1956 is when I started, fall of 56.
And coming from San Antonio, what were your impressions of Stillwater?
Well, of course, I hadn't been on that many college campuses. My dad had gone around and visited the University of Texas and Rice and SMU. I didn't know what to expect, but even then, Oklahoma State was a beautiful campus. We had some outstanding facilities here then, and of course, they've been improved quite a bit since in the last 50 years. But the library and the Student Union building particularly were just beautiful facilities, and I always felt at home here, even though I didn't know very many people, didn't know hardly anybody when I came up here. There are a lot of folks that made me feel at home, and it's a good place to go to school.
Now tell me a little bit about the baseball facilities back then.
Well, of course, we played at the same place you're playing now. They were not nearly as nice. We had a chain link fence. Of course, the grass wasn't as nice. Didn't have any locker rooms for the teams. But you know, it was the same dimensions as far as I can tell. And the seating, it didn't have as much seating as is available now.
And did you have to work as part of your scholarship?
Yes, sure did.
And what was your on-campus job?
Well, I don't remember all of it, but it depends. I think the fellow's name was McElroy, the man that was in charge of that, and he'd assign us whatever he wanted us to do that day. I can remember one thing that stands out. I used to change light bulbs in West Bennett Hall. It was a big, and East Bennett too, I guess, but it hasn't changed much. I haven't been inside, but it's the same size. It's a big building, has a lot of light bulbs to change. But, you know, I remember occasionally we'd go out and rake the baseball field and do some other chores around the field, but whatever he wanted us to do that day, we would do.
Okay. So, tell me about playing for the team. What position did you start out as? I know you changed a little bit throughout your career here.
I did. I started out, of course, being an infielder like I was in high school. And my freshmen were not eligible to play then, and I couldn't play it anyway. I wasn't good enough. My sophomore year, I was a second-team third baseman. A fellow named Jerry Webster played ahead of me, and Jerry Adair, who was later a major leaguer, played shortstop. And Adair that year was a junior, and Jerry Webster was a sophomore, so I thought, they're going to be around next year, too, so I really didn't think I was going to get much chance to play. But sometime before the school year started, I found that both of them had signed professional contracts. So, you know, I decided maybe I better get ready to play some ball. And that sophomore year, I think I'd only been in a half dozen games. And I remember very specifically, I got up to bat 16 times and got 3 hits. That's a batting average of about 186. So didn't do very well that year. But when I found out that I might play, I got real serious about playing. And I went on a program. I got my dad to hollow out the barrel of a bat and put lead in it, liquid lead, which made a very heavy bat. And for about 6 months, I swung that bat 1,000 times every night. About 500 times just cracking my wrist, and then the other 500 a full swing. And in addition to that, I lifted weights and ate 4 meals a day, so I put on about 20 pounds of weight. So I went from about 160 to about 180 or 185. And I went from being a second team third baseman my sophomore year to being a second team All-American my junior year when we won the national championship.
Wow, that's amazing, the work you put in.
Well, it paid off for me. You know, it made me a whole lot better ball player.
Now that year, your junior year, the national championship
yes.
year, you led the team in home runs and RBIs while hitting 3.14.
Yes.
That is crazy. How was that? Was that practice, that lead bat, you think it really helped?
It helped a whole lot. You know, I had a little problem with my bat speed my freshman and sophomore years, and by the time the season started, after I'd swung that lead bat that many times every night for about 6 months, regular bat felt like a toothpick, so it just enabled me to swing a lot faster, get my bat speed up considerably.
So tell me a little bit now about the preseason workouts under Gallagher at the Hall.
Well, we went through that facility the way it is now, and I wouldn't recognize it because it was just an old clay dirt floor, and we had a batting cage, and it was musty. But we had to practice down there for a month or two before the season started, and even then, it was still too cold to play up here in February and early March, so we'd make a road trip down to Texas and play at Sam Houston State or University of Houston or Rice. We would usually play at least 2 teams down there and then come back to start a schedule here when the weather got a little better.
So how would you travel as a team to road games?
Well, back then we traveled by car. And my friend Tim Green and I, we always got assigned to ride with Coach Green and his wife. And that was an experience itself. Coach Green never said much. His wife did about 90% of the talking while we were on trips. And we'd pull into some place to have lunch. And we'd go in, and Tim and I'd order a hamburger. And about the time we were halfway through, Coach Green would be out there honking on the horn. So it was quite an experience to travel with Coach and Marie Green.
Wow. So all the players were assigned to different people to travel with?
Well, the older players got to... They took their own cars and they got paid mileage for it.
Okay. Things are a lot different nowadays.
Oh, yes. Yeah, everything's different. This whole facility is different. And much for the better. It was a nice facility then, we thought, but nothing compared to what you have here today.
Well, that Cowboy team in 1959, you know, they weren't expected to do much.
Not hardly. I mean, we started with... sophomores, never played a game, starting catcher, first baseman, second baseman, and third baseman. Bob Andrew played shortstop, and he'd been in the service, came back out of the service, and then Connie McElvoy and Don Sorgel rotated in left field. I don't think either one of them had ever played college ball. And Tim Green played right field, and I played center field, and we just played a little bit, you know, the previous year. So we really had 2 veterans, Joe Horlen and Roy Peterson, our 2 main pitchers, and of course Dick Sorgel turned out to be a great pitcher too, but starting the year, those 2 veterans, Joe Horlen and Roy Peterson, were the only thing we had, and nobody expected much out of us.
Did you and your teammates think that you would be, you know, a great team and actually have the potential to compete for that national title?
You know, we never talked about it. I suppose at some point we had that in mind. You know, when it became obvious we could compete for the Big 8 championship. It was the Big 8 then. And then I guess, I don't know, when we got up to Omaha, I imagine some of us shaking our heads and thinking, what are we doing up here? But we did think we were pretty good. And it turned out that we did have a good team. And I think we exceeded expectations. And one reason was we just got along so well. It was good chemistry. We didn't have any people with big egos, and we all liked each other, all got along well. Nobody ever got their feelings hurt or anything, and we just had a good chemistry as a team.
Hmm. What were some of the other strengths of the club outside of teamwork that led to such a magical run?
Well, we had a lot of good competitors. Almost everybody on the team is a good competitor. Two that stand out in my mind, Dick Sorgel and Bruce Andrew, our little second baseman, were both tremendous competitors. I talked to Dick about that this morning. I mean, even taking batting practice, Dick Sorgel never threw you an easy pitch. I mean, anytime you were competing against Dick, it was game time. And of course, that made us better hitters too. But he was such a competitor that even in batting practice, you had to work to hit Dick Sorgel. And Bruce, I remember when I was a freshman, Bruce Andrew was playing second base, and he was working on his double play throw and trying to get rid of the ball very quickly, and about half of what he was throwing was going into the dugout, and several of us were kind of laughing about it. And he wound up being a top flight second baseman and played professional baseball, and wound up, his occupation was as a baseball scout. But he didn't care what anybody else thought. He worked until he got that double play combination down right and made a tremendous second baseman. But we had a lot of competitors on that team.
Was there a significant game or turning point that season that you recall?
I remember one swing, and I had a good year, but going into the national tournament, and I wasn't playing well. I only got two or three hits, didn't get hardly any hits until the final game, and felt real bad about it. And we were playing the University of Arizona in the final game, and in the top of the seventh inning, we were down 3-2. And I led off the inning and hit a home run over the left field fence, which tied the game, and I think gave us some momentum, at least that's the way I look at it. And then we went on and scored two more runs, and that was the end of the game. We beat them 5-3. Wasn't the end of the game, but we finished it on out. If it hadn't been for that one swing, you know, I would have had a hard time feeling good about being a member of the team, because I didn't feel like I'd done my part in the College World Series. But just that one swing made up for it. Because, and I still, I thank God every once in a while, you know, for that one swing.
What a great memory. Looking back at that regular season before the College World Series, what was the most memorable game for you that you can recall?
Before the College World Series? Mm-hmm. I remember hitting a grand slam home run against Oklahoma University over the 400-foot sign in right center field, and that was a good experience for me.
Was Bedlam still a big thing back then? The rivalry between?
Oh yeah, sure. You bet. Everybody wanted to beat OU.
Still do. So, the 59 team, we qualified for the College World Series. Back then, was the College World Series a big deal like it is today?
It was. The people of Omaha have always done a great job at promoting the College World Series. I think, I talked to Roy Peterson, he said he thinks the first time they had a College World Series was somewhere around 1950. And it started in Omaha, and they still have it because they just do such an outstanding job. They promote it real well, and the whole town turns out. You know, they really get involved in the College World Series in Omaha, Nebraska.
So take me through that time. What was it like going up there? And just give me a snapshot of that whole experience for me.
Well, you know, it's kind of hard to summarize the whole experience. It was a little bit like going to the other road games that we went to, only on a bigger scale, you know, a lot bigger crowds, and of course we knew what was at stake. We weren't just playing for a Big Eight game, you know, that we were playing for the national championship, and got pretty serious about it, and we got beat early in the series by University of Arizona, and we were fortunate enough to win enough games to come back and play them in the finals, but it was just a great experience. People were good to us, treated us real well, and we had a lot of fun. at the same time took our business pretty seriously.
What was the atmosphere like?
You mean around the team or the town or what?
Just around the team, around the town, when you would enter the stadium, what was it like? Did you have a lot of fans in attendance?
We didn't have a whole lot of fans, mostly with family. Some of our family members were up there, but there wasn't a big following of Oklahoma State people. I think a lot of Oklahoma Staters were listening on the radio, but at that time you didn't have a lot of fans traveling with the team. We had some, and we'd see them around town, you know, but we didn't have a big following at the World Series.
Outside of the memory you shared, hitting the home run in the College World Series, do you have any other special memories?
Well, they're all pretty special. You know, I don't know, like I say, it's 50 years ago, it's kind of hard to remember. If you asked me that 10 years after I got out of school, I could probably think of some other high points, but just generally it was a good year all year. We had a lot of fun playing together. We had a lot of guys on the team had good senses of humor. You know, we were serious about what we were doing, but at the same time, we had a lot of fun. We had a good time and enjoyed being around each other and playing ball with each other.
How special it is for you to have been a member of the only OSU baseball team to date to win that NCAA championship?
It's very special, and, you know, we might not have been the best team that Oklahoma State's ever had. We probably weren't. I remember Coach Green, that right after that, after we won it, said that his 1954 team was, it was 54, I think, was a better team, and they probably were. I know something about the guys that played on that team. But it takes a lot of good fortune, you know, along the way if you win a national championship. You not only have to be good, but you've got to have some good breaks. And there are probably two or three things, if they hadn't happened the way they did, you know, we probably wouldn't have won it. I remember watching Oklahoma State one year after that when they played Georgia, University of Georgia, in the final game. And I really felt like Oklahoma State had the better team that year and should have won it. But that particular year, the major television channel that was televising the game, they required that the final game that they broadcast be the game. Now, at that time, Oklahoma State had not lost any games. You know, when we played, it was a double elimination. And that year, Oklahoma State went to the finals and hadn't lost any. University of Georgia had lost one game already. So any time before that, Georgia would have had to beat Oklahoma State twice. But that particular year, it was, they decided that was going to be the final game, and if Georgia won that one game, then they won the College World Series, and they did. And I watched that game, and I felt like if it had been a two-game series like it should have been, that the OSU team would have won that year. Hmm. And I know Gary Ward had some great teams here, had some great players and some great teams. And a number of which could have won the World Series. But as I say, you've got to be pretty good and you've got to have some breaks along the way. And they just didn't have enough breaks to win a second championship. But I'm sure a lot of those teams were capable of doing it.
Absolutely. So after the 59 team wins the College World Series and you come back to Stillwater, is there hype?
So I don't remember a whole lot of people welcoming us back at that time. It wasn't like these scenes I see today, you know, when a winning football or basketball team comes back home and the whole gymnasium is full of fans. I don't remember many people being around because, like I say, the World Series was after the school year ended when we ended the season, and there weren't that many people around campus anymore.
Over the years, have you stayed in touch with many of your teammates?
Quite a few, probably more Roy Peterson and Tim Green than the rest. And we've been together a couple times as a group. Once we had a 10-year reunion, I think, and then we had one 10 years ago when they inducted our team into the Hall of Honor. That's the only two times that we've been able to get together as a group. But I do visit with them occasionally on the phone. A great bunch of guys, and wish we were 50 years younger.
And how special is this reunion for you here today?
It's very special. Very special. It's always good to get together with these guys, and I can't tell you how much we appreciate what the school did for us putting this together. It means a lot to all of us.
You mentioned some players that you're particularly close to. Are there some players that you just have enjoyed reminiscing with this weekend?
Oh, yeah, all of them. And I should have mentioned Joe Horlen, somebody I stay in pretty close contact with, too, because Joe and I grew up together. As I say, we started playing ball together when we were 14 and played some summer ball together and then came up here to school together. So I do stay in touch with Joe quite a bit.
Any thoughts of ever playing professionally or in the minor leagues?
Yeah, I thought about it, and I didn't really have the opportunity, so I decided to go to law school. And it was probably a good thing because I don't think I had the potential. I didn't have the ability to play Major League Baseball. And, you know, on reflection, I probably would have spent a couple of years in the minor leagues and then done something else. So it worked out all right for me.
You graduated from OSU in which year?
1960.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then after you graduated, what did you go on to do?
Well, I went to law school the following fall, got out of law school, and then went into the Marine Corps for 3 years. Served 3 years on active duty, including service in Vietnam. Then got out and started practicing law in private practice, and I've been practicing law ever since.
Okay. Now, baseball has changed quite a bit over the years. In your opinion, how has college baseball ball changed?
Well, I think a major change is the aluminum bats. It makes a big difference. I understand. I've never hit a ball with an aluminum bat. We always use wooden bats. And I guess the reason they changed is because of economics. You know, we used to break a lot of bats, and bats were expensive. Aluminum bats, I don't think, break. But that's a big change. Other than that, you know, the pitcher's mound still 60 feet 6 inches, and the bases are still 90 feet apart, and I don't see that much of a change.
So you've toured around today, and you've seen the facilities here. What do you think about the current facilities and the proposed new stadium?
I think it's outstanding. I just finished Boone Pickens' book, and when I get back home, I plan on writing him a letter and telling him how much I appreciate what he's done for this university. And I know he's not the only one either. There's a lot of people that have contributed to what this university is today, and it's a tremendous facility we can all be proud of.
Now, how has the campus changed since you were a student?
So many more buildings. You know, Bennett Hall is still here. That's where I started. But there's so many more buildings. Of course, the football field has expanded. The basketball, Gallagher-Iba Arena is much bigger. It's just a much bigger place. It's a big campus now. When I was here, we had about 10,000 students, and I imagine there's 30 or 40,000 now. So that's the main thing. It's just so much bigger. It's always been a beautiful campus. Still is a beautiful campus.
Going back to your time on campus, where did you live as a student?
I lived four or five places. I started out in Bennett Hall. I spent a short period of time. Mike Mulvihill reminded me, he and I shared an apartment or a small house for a period of time. I lived in a fraternity house for a year or so. And four of us, including Tim Green's brother and a couple of other guys, we rented a house for a year and stayed in a house, the four of us. So I stayed in quite a few places on campus.
And do you have favorite hangouts, both on campus, off campus?
Well, of course, on campus, I love the library. I always enjoyed reading, and we had a tremendous library then. It was a beautiful building, and whatever you wanted, it was there. Student Union Building was state of the art. It was a great facility. As far as off campus, I really can't remember anything. There were a couple of haunts, of Deeks and Louis or something like that we'd go into occasionally. But I can't remember a whole lot of places off campus. Of course, the downtown area, I drove down there a little bit today. A lot of it looks like just like it did then to me.
Was it hard balancing school with team practice?
Well, not as hard as it is now. You know, I can't imagine these young men playing 60 or 70 games a year and making grades. You know, our total season, the year we won the national championship, was 32 games. And even then, you know, you missed a lot of class time. So my hat's off to them. If they can play 60 or 70 games and make their grades, they're working hard at those studies. But it'd be awfully difficult for me to have done that.
What was graduation like for you?
In the truth, I don't remember much about it. I think we had it in the football stadium, as I recall. And I can't even remember walking across the stage. You know, when you get to be my age, you'll realize that you have a hard time sometimes remembering what you had for breakfast. But I can't remember a whole lot about the ceremony, except I was there and glad to be there.
Any special memories of Oklahoma State that just stand out among all others?
No, it was just a great little college town, and still is as far as I can tell. You know, it's not like going to SMU in Dallas or going to the University of Texas at Austin. It's just a smaller community, and you know, I think it's just a great place for a young man or a young lady to go to school. It's a college town, and I love the college atmosphere. And I just wouldn't take for the experience here, and I'd highly recommend it to any young boy or girl that's thinking about some place to go to school.
Well, we talked a little bit about the 59 team and your experiences here on campus. Is there anything else you'd like to mention today that we haven't really asked?
I can't think of anything, Juliana, except to thank you and everybody that's been involved in putting this together. I know that I can speak for everybody when I say we really appreciate it. It's nice to be remembered after 50 years, and it's been a tremendous experience for all of us.
Well, we appreciate you, and congratulations again on winning the national championship in 59. Even if you didn't have a crowd then, you have a good crowd out here cheering you on today.
Thank you, Juliana. Go Cowboys.